We still have folks coming in, so we're going to give it a few minutes before we get started. So hang in there. So we're going to wait a few more minutes. We have people still coming in, so we're going to get started in about 5 minutes or so. There's still people checking in. Hello, everybody. Before we get started, I'd like to read our code of conduct. The AFL-CIO is committed to providing an environment free from discrimination and harassment. We ask all event participants to embrace our values of equity and equality and conduct themselves in this event consistent with those values. President Trumka has assigned Joe Kekaris as the first point of contact for anyone who thinks they've experienced discriminatory, harassing, or otherwise unacceptable behavior, and we urge you to contact him if you have any concerns. Joe, if you didn't already stand up. Okay, and his number is here on the easel. So welcome to the House of Labor and to our event programming series, Ideas at Work. Ideas at Work is an event series that we host to capture activism happening in America and in our workplaces, and we're glad you can join us this afternoon for this event with Robert Kuttner in conversation with President Trumka regarding his new book, Can Democracy Survive Global Capitalism? And before we get started, three quick housekeeping items. First, we encourage you to sign up for our Ideas at Work SMS list, and you can do that by texting IDEAS to 235-246. Second, I wanted to share with you an event we have next Tuesday. Dr. Mona Hanna Atisha, otherwise known as the Flint Whistleblower. She's an immigrant, doctor, scientist, Time Top 100 TED-Med speaker. She was at our convention in October, and she was amazing. So if you can come out next Tuesday evening, that event's at 5:30. And finally, if you're tweeting, please tweet using hashtag Ideas at Work. And now I'm going to turn it over to President Trumka.
Thanks, Christine, for the introduction and for all the work you've done in putting this together. And I want to welcome all of you to the AFL-CIO for this very, very important discussion. I want to tell you, back in 1984, I was the president of the mine workers, and I was up in New England at Harvard minding my own business when I get a call from a guy by the name of Bob Kuttner, who says that he and Barry Bluestone and Jeff Foe would like to meet with me. I said, sure, I'd be happy to meet with you. And we sit down and we started talking about Brookings that had started to migrate to the right. In fact, it was more of a migration. It was more like a stampede at that point. And Bob Kuttner says, we need a think tank for progressives that actually talks for progressives. And I said, you're right. And he goes, good, glad you agree. I want you to pledge $100,000 a year for 5 years. And quite frankly, I did. There were four or five of us that came together at that time, pledged the money to start EPI. Jeff Foe became its first president, and EPI went from a thought process to a reality to the powerhouse that it is today, in large part because of the push, the foresight, and the hard work of Bob Kuttner. So, Bob, we have a lot of things to thank you for, but that's an additional one. Bob's book, quite frankly, couldn't be more timely. I've said for years that the economy's not like the weather, that it just doesn't happen to us, that the economy is nothing but a set of rules, and those rules are written by the people that we elect, both here and around the world. Massive inequality, stagnant wages, a diminishing social safety net, unfair trade, mass migration, these outcomes simply are not inevitable. They're the result of deliberate policy choices and decisions. And we can choose, if we want to do better. Bob's book asked the pivotal question, can democracy survive global capitalism? In a 2016 Harvard study, it paints a very, very troubling picture. It finds that only 30% of millennials believe it's essential to live in a democratic nation. And of the 70% that think it isn't essential, 24% actually said it's bad to live in a democracy. Now, they've seen global capitalism up close, and quite frankly, they aren't really impressed with it. So we're at a very historic crossroads right now. Will we continue down this destructive path, or will we find our way back with a set of economic rules that really do work for working people? Now, all over our country, people are speaking out for a bold new direction. Workers are organizing and striking as we haven't seen in years. We're seeing more collective action than we've ever seen in years, whether it's teachers, students, Black Lives Matter, the Me Too movement, all of those are collective action. Candidates are for office are running to labor instead of to Wall Street. And the popularity of unions is at a rather high. It's one of our highs. We've seen it's up over 60%. It's even higher with young people. And even 55% of young Republicans are supportive of unions. And a new research study from MIT shows that a 50% increase in the percentage of non-union workers who say that they would vote to join a union if given the opportunity. That's tremendous. So from coast to coast, working people are recognizing that the best way to raise our own standing is by standing with the person next to us. So working people are writing a comeback story. And I can't help but think of Bob's book as their user manual and this important fight. Every, and I mean every, progressive should read his book. It's not only educational, it's also a roadmap forward for progressives. We probably ought to start quizzing some of our candidates, Bob, on whether they've read the book or not and whether they subscribe to it. So look, I've talked too much. Please join me in welcoming the co-founder and co-editor of The American Prospect and a professor at Brandeis University, my friend, our friend, Bob Kuttner. Bob.
Rich, thanks so much. I've done a lot of book talks about this book, and there is none that I've looked forward to more than this one. I started this book in 2007 as an exploration of how hyperglobalism undermined the project of managing capitalism, or to put it more politically, how elites use the ever-expanding definition of free global commerce to destroy key elements of a mixed economy. Now, when you think about it, there is a complete contradiction between what we have learned through bitter struggle over the past 150 years, that markets are not self-regulating. Markets do crazy things. Markets price things wrong. They price labor wrong. They price education wrong. They price R&D wrong. They price pollution wrong. But somehow, when commerce crosses international borders, we are expected to believe that markets are perfectly efficient just the same. This is completely crazy. And the the project after World War II that succeeded so well for three decades was really about harnessing, housebreaking capitalism with the power of ordinary working people so that we could have a socially just economy. And it worked. It worked better than any form of economy before or since. Not only did the economy grow at a record pace, but it became more equal. And we did this by leashing the more unsavory tendencies of capitalism, particularly financial capitalism. Now, in the 70s, what happened was very simple. We had a rough decade. We had a rough decade because of the OPEC oil increase, price increases. We had a rough decade because Bretton Woods blew up and Richard Nixon was otherwise engaged with Watergate. And instead of seeing the travails of the early 1970s as a kind of bump in the road and adjusting policy accordingly, elites chose this occasion to reassert their power. And so all of the lessons that we had bitterly learned after 1929 and in the 1930s were unlearned. We had an unfortunate presidency under Jimmy Carter. We had a very unfortunate chair of the Federal Reserve under Paul Volcker, who decided that the way to slay inflation was to put interest rates up to 21%. And so people whose ideas were completely discredited by history, they got another turn at bat. And Reagan in the United States and Thatcher in Britain used their turn at bat to dismantle as many of the great accomplishments of the post-war social contract as they possibly could. Now, I have been writing about the fraught relationship between democracy and capitalism and a socially just economy in 11 books. I started doing this in 1979 when I wrote my first book, which was about Proposition 13 in California. That book was actually titled Revolt of the Haves. I might have been 30 years too early with that title. But the point of that book, if you think about where Proposition 13 came from, is that when political elites ignore economic pain that is experienced by ordinary people, crazy right-wing nuts get to take power. That was Howard Jarvis in 1978. And 40 years later, it is the same damn story. When the political establishment ignores the pain of regular people, the right gets back in. And so in this book, I decided to take a deeper look at the role of globalization, which I'm going to define in a minute, in undermining one of the great accomplishments of history, which was the post-war social contract. And some people have argued, Tom Friedman is one, Milton Friedman is another one, that democracy and capitalism logically go together. You can make the argument that capitalism requires property rights, and that in turn requires rule of law. And if you're going to have an efficient economy, that requires transparency. Well, history shows that capitalism works tolerably well only when democracy is strong enough to leash it, only when democracy is strong enough to regulate it. Otherwise, its toxic tendencies overwhelm its benign tendencies, and you get a terrible reaction by ordinary people who can't take it anymore and give up on mainstream political parties and vote for the far right. And we are at risk of repeating what happened in the 1920s, where the market economy goes nuts and things that should not be marketized are marketized, and financial markets go haywire and unemployment rises and ordinary people can't take it anymore, and you get Mussolini, you get Hitler, you get war. Now, my great hero in the larger story that I tell is an economic historian by the name of Karl Polanyi. And Polanyi's masterwork was written in 1944. It's a book called The Great Transformation. And Polanyi's story is very simple. He goes back to England in the 18th century, and his story is what happens politically when you let markets go haywire, when markets take over everything, when markets disrupt daily life to the point where people don't have security, they don't have predictability. And it's very simple. People vote for dictators. People would rather put their trust in a dictator than put their trust in a democracy that creates outcomes that are completely disdainful of them. And supposedly, we learned this lesson in the 20s, we learned this lesson in the 30s, and above all, we learned this lesson from World War II. And so I went back and I did a deep dive into how the post-war social contract was constructed and how it came unglued. And I realized that 1944, which was when the architecture for the post-war system was put in place, was really a kind of harmonic convergence, one part social movement and one part lucky circumstances. And let me go through this. There's a lovely book that I draw on somewhat by a historian named Jeff Cowie called The Great Exception. And Cowie is writing about Roosevelt and the New Deal. And my argument is that the Great Exception was not just the New Deal. It was the whole post-war period. And in order for the post-war period to play out the way it did, think of all of the things that had to happen. First of all, Roosevelt had to get elected. And if you think about what might have been, you may recall your history that in February of 1933, before he was inaugurated, the president-elect was giving a speech in Miami, and an assassin by the name of Joe Zangara got within a few feet of Roosevelt, and he fired five shots, point blank. He was a lousy shot. He missed the mayor of Chicago. Roosevelt hit the mayor of Chicago instead. And you think about what the New Deal might have been if he'd hit Roosevelt. You would have had Cactus Jack Garner, a non-entity from Texas who was put on the ticket for ticket balancing purposes as the president in 1933. Garner is famous, of course, for saying that the vice presidency is not worth a bucket of warm spit, except he didn't say spit. So we got very, very lucky that we got Roosevelt. And Roosevelt was quite radical. Roosevelt was radical enough to really leash Wall Street. He was radical enough to empower labor. He was radical enough to make a majority politics out of taking on the malefactors of great wealth, and famously said, they hate me and I welcome their hatred. Doesn't sound very much like Bill Clinton or even Barack Obama. So for starters, we had Roosevelt. And then we had the success of the New Deal compounded by the success of World War II in demonstrating to a country that doesn't like government very much that government can do great things for ordinary people. And you all know your labor history well enough to know that it wasn't just the Wagner Act, it was the role of labor during World War II that really entrenched the labor movement as a legitimate, valued social partner. And then on the other side of the Atlantic, we had not just the fascist right defeated, but we had the libertarian right discredited by events, and we had the corporate right, many of whom had gotten into bed with Hitler, discredited by the way events played out. So if you look at what happened in 1944 at Bretton Woods, which was the great conference that created the architecture of the post-war international economic system. The architect of that was, of course, John Maynard Keynes. The U.S. Treasury was oddly in the hands of left-wingers. Harry Dexter White was Keynes's counterpart. White was later accused of being a communist, and he may well have been a communist. So the point is, things were very anomalous. The most conservative cabinet department, the Treasury, was in the hands of radicals. And the whole post-war system was designed so that we could kind of have a global New Deal. And at the absolute center of this was leashing finance. The Bretton Woods system used fixed exchange rates so that you could not have speculation in currencies, which meant that all the categories of products, financial products that blew up in 2008 could not exist because you could not speculate in currency values because currency values were fixed. You had controls on international capital movements. You had a gradual movement towards the restoration of commerce, but you did not have what today is called free trade. You had the ability of each nation state as a democracy to negotiate its own social contract. And you had very strongly empowered unions. The third pillar of the Bretton Woods institutions, which was never ratified by the United States Senate, was the International Trade Organization. And the International Trade Organization charter very deliberately gave countries the right to discriminate against imports if that was necessary to protect labor standards. That never made it into the post-war system, but even so, there was a kind of inertial power of the labor movement that carried on for another 30 or 40 years. So it took the harmonic convergence of all of these pieces to be in place for us to create a very unusual form of managed capitalism. And I think those of you who are my generation, we just grew up thinking that this was normal, that this was just the way it was, that there had been a resetting of the rules during and after the war, and that Eisenhower, who the Democrats wanted to nominate for president before the Republicans didn't fight it. The Me Too party was the Republicans. The Republicans wanted to do imitations of what the Democrats did, only a little bit less. And we thought that this was permanent. Well, silly us. Because what happened was that the residual power of capital in a capitalist economy was temporarily repressed. And it only took the right set of circumstances for the residual power of capitalism, of capital in a capitalist economy, to come roaring back. And I think historians will long debate whether the turn that occurred in the 1970s had to occur. I am on the side of the debate that says no, that did not have to occur. There was nothing inherent about the dynamics of capitalism that required us to revert to a pre-1929 model. The 70s were a combination of bad luck, bad policy, bad leadership. Brother Trumka invoked Jeff Foe, and I vividly remember in the 70s, Jeff and Gar Alperovitz and others were talking about the four necessities and the fact that the inflation in housing and healthcare and energy and food prices, this was not macroeconomic. Each of these had its own structural story. We could have had structural policies to damp down inflation in the necessities. We could have had an incomes policy to break the wage price spiral without trying to break unions or without putting interest rates up to 21%. But the convergence of Carter, a weak president, and Volcker, and bad policies really set the stage for Reagan. And we had a similar story in Britain, where conflict between strong unions and a labor party that really did not know how to get along with them set the stage for the so-called winter of discontent in 1979. A lot of wildcat strikes, rubbish piling up on the streets, ambulance drivers not picking up sick patients, and the middle class getting disgusted with this, and that sets the stage for Thatcher. So history, I have long felt, is a mixture of deep structural forces and lucky or unlucky accidents and political movements. And so you tell that story and you look at the present situation, you appreciate that what happened in the years after 1980 was that the people who had seized control of the rules of the global economy used it very strategically to undermine step by step in a cumulative way what remained of a more managed form of capitalism. And globalization became the instrument. And I tell a story in the book that I call A Tale of Two Socialists, where I compare Clement Attlee with François Mitterrand. And it's really very interesting. So it's July of 1945, and the British Labour Party has won a landslide election against Winston Churchill. The British public had said, thank you very much, Prime Minister Churchill. We're very grateful that you won the war, and now we've had 20 years of just wretched economics, and it's our turn. And so they elect the first majority Labour government. Now, Britain went totally broke during the war. It suffered the loss of a million dwelling units. It suffered the loss of a quarter of its national wealth. And what did Attlee do? Oh, and it had a debt-to-GDP ratio of 240% at the end of World War II. Now, if the current rules were in place, the IMF and the World Bank and Peter G. Peterson would have said to Attlee, well, my friend, you need to reassure Britain's creditors, because if you don't, speculators will attack the pound. So you better go on an austerity binge, same way they said to Alexis Tsipras in Greece. What did Attlee do? He built a welfare state. He built the National Health Service. He used the high wartime rates of taxation, top rate of 98%, to invest in Britain's recovery. And why did the international speculators not batter down the value of the pound? Because the rules of the game in 1945 prohibited that. The rules of the game were designed in order to create a safe harbor for individual nations to create whatever kind of social contract they wanted. And so Attlee and the Labour Party, the Labour government, built the welfare state. And Britain had full employment. And Britain's creditors be damned. Now, you fast forward 35 years. François Mitterrand also becomes, in this case, president of France, the first socialist president with a majority socialist majority in the Chamber of Deputies, and a very progressive program. 35-hour work week, nationalization of basic industry, nationalization of the banks, changer la vie. And what happens? Well, within a year and a half, he has to reverse course with his tail between his legs because speculators are battering down the value of the franc. Why could they do that in 1981, but not in 1945? Because the ground rules of globalization have been changed by the globalist elites. The whole book can be summed up in that little anecdote. And it only gets worse after 1981, because the trade rules, the Uruguay Round, the WTO, one after another, they are designed to make perfectly legitimate, perfectly normal ways of regulating capitalism incompatible with their notion of free trade. That the idea of takings, that you're taking somebody's property without just compensation, which has never been found to be consistent with American law, even by conservative Supreme Courts, the doctrine of takings becomes enshrined in international trade law. That's what investor state is. The idea that if you have perfectly ordinary forms of health, safety, worker, environmental regulation, you're somehow taking somebody's property without their consent. And just as financial elites captured and hijacked the rules of the game, that can be changed. All it takes is politics. And in the great debate about neoliberalism, versus progressivism, that debate is not going to be resolved by me debating Al Fromm. It's not going to be resolved by Elizabeth Warren debating Hillary Clinton. It's going to be resolved by taking power. It's going to be resolved by taking power. That's how Roosevelt demonstrated that a managed form of capitalism with strong elements of social democracy could be more efficient as well as more equitable than laissez-faire capitalism. And tragically, that's how Reagan and Thatcher took back their side of the debate by taking back power. So to fast forward a few decades, when this social contract got abrogated by a shift in political power, which in turn changed the ground rules, ordinary people started taking it on the chin. And also tragically and needlessly, when so-called center-left governments were elected in the 1990s, Clinton in the United States, Gerhard Schroeder of the SPD in Germany, Tony Blair in the UK, instead of using this moment to put back together something more reminiscent of the post-war social contract, what did they do? Basically, they said, you know, Reagan and Thatcher were at least half right. Bill Clinton said a lot of disparaging things about government. Gerhard Schroeder deregulated capital markets and labor markets in a way that conservatives never would have dared. Tony Blair got very close to the city, which is Britain's version of Wall Street, in the same way that Bill Clinton hired Bob Rubin and got very cozy with Wall Street. Clinton is responsible for more deregulation than either of the Bushes or Reagan, particularly financial deregulation. And so when it really hit the fan in 2008, as a result of all of this deregulation and globalization that did not serve regular people, that served elites, and ordinary people got more and more frustrated, and they looked around for somebody who might champion their interests. It wasn't the British Labor Party. It wasn't the American Democratic Party, certainly not the presidential wing. And it wasn't the SPD in Germany. Margaret Thatcher, after she retired, was asked by a reporter, what do you think your greatest accomplishment was? And she thought for a minute, and she said, my greatest accomplishment was Tony Blair. And that was toxic in two senses. First of all, it meant that the Labor Party was ceasing to be an opposition party in any meaningful way. And secondly, it meant that she had won the ideological debate. She was famous for saying, there is no alternative, T-I-N-A, Tina. And Tony Blair seemed to be agreeing. So given all of that, 40 years of declining security, 40 years of declining respect, it's not surprising that if you get just the right circumstances, which tragically we did in 2016, that somebody like Donald Trump gets elected. And of course, it isn't just Trump. The same thing is happening all over the West, which suggests to you that this is more than a coincidence, it's more than a contagion, it's the same dynamics. It's elites destroy the social contract, masses become very disheartened, they lose confidence even in the nominally center-left party, and they turn to neo-fascists. It's an old story. Marx got a lot of things right. He got one big thing wrong, and that is when capitalism runs amok, the workers of the world don't unite. The workers of the world turn to local neo-fascists. Marx left out nationalism. He wished it away. And so there's more than one form of globalization. That's one of the lessons of the research that I did. The form of globalization that was deliberately created in 1944 was very carefully designed so that the restarting of trade, the restarting of cross-border investment did not interfere with the ability of countries to have their own social contracts. And we could have that back. That's why the trade issue is so important. And at the end of the day, our version of this is much more persuasive than Donald Trump's, A, because he's incompetent, B, because he's a phony. That even though he postures populist, his real friends are the corporate crowd. And I want to come to this more in the discussion, but it's very important that we get that story right. Basically, to boil it down to a one-liner, it's very useful that he has blown up the old trade paradigm, but all of the particular things he's doing are unhelpful. Some of them tactically could be helpful. Tariffs used well as part of a resetting of the entire trade regime, sure, but you have to have somebody who knows what he or she is doing. And if you go back and look at this kind of accident in slow motion, where ordinary people are feeling more and more frustrated, it's very important to get the relative weight of economics and cultural issues right, or you will really screw up the politics. And if you I like to think about it this way. If working people look at somebody who they see as a representative of the Davos crowd, and that person is not only paying little attention to kitchen table economics, but is going further and disparaging them for being losers of globalization, then it's not just an economic assault, it's an affront to people's dignity. And people conclude that, oh yeah, the same crowd who really don't care about me, who look down on me, they're the same crowd who want to take away my guns, they're the same crowd who thinks it's okay to kill a fetus in utero, they're the same people who make fun of my church, and they're the same people who care more about immigrants than they care about me, and they're the same people who care more about bathrooms than they care about whether I have a job. Now, that's not exactly a winning politics. And Sherrod Brown can make this speech much better than I do, but if you lead with the pocketbook stuff, and you are credible on the pocketbook stuff, regular people will cut you some slack on the social issues. If you lead with the social issues and don't do anything for regular people's pocketbook issues, you are toast. And that's the balance that we have to get right going forward. So to conclude, my mentor, Professor Galbraith, used to say, you always have to say in conclusion to give the audience hope. In conclusion, let me respond to my own question. Can democracy survive global capitalism? No, it cannot. However, democracy can survive a more social form of economy, and whether or not we get a more social form of democracy and reclaim our democracy altogether is a matter of whether we build a movement, and there's no better place to begin that than with the labor movement. Thanks so much.
Great job, Bob. So let me start off the questions. At the end of your book, you call for a progressive populism as a genuine alternative to the devil's choice that we have now between authoritarianism on one hand and neoliberalism on the other hand. What hope do you see for progressive populism emerging as a major force in the 2018 elections, and what steps should working people be taking to make it become that force?
Well, Rich, you and I were talking before the event, and we asked each other, are you feeling optimistic? And we both confessed that we're both feeling very optimistic. I was in Europe a couple of weeks ago. I gave a bunch of talks, and I explained that the one place I was actually feeling optimistic about was the United States of America. And the reason for that is that if you look around Europe, it is a wasteland of labor and social democratic parties that are just screened out of power with no plausible way you can imagine for them to get back to power. A lot of the base that normally votes for social democrats and for labor parties is voting for neo-fascists. But if you compare that with the United States, we have a two-party system. We have a president who is in the course of self-destructing, and we have a Democratic Party that is really being taken over by progressives. And that's, I couldn't have said that any time in the last, 50 years. The odds are, if we do our homework, that we will take back the House. If you extrapolate from the five special elections, where the average swing was 21 or 22 points, that adds up to something like 60 or 70 seats. We may not get 60 or 70 seats. They may steal 20, but I think we probably will get 40 or 50. And I think also, looking forward to 2020, the odds are that a progressive will get the nomination. That's not going to happen automatically, but I think looking at the field, the Wall Street Democrats are probably more likely to crowd each other out and do each other in than the three or four progressive Democrats, and certainly one of the two finalists is going to be a progressive. So I think if you look at all of the energy from all of the movements, that's progressive energy. That's not Clintonism on the march. That's not the DLC on the march. And then I think the next president in 2020 has to be at least as radical as Roosevelt in empowering labor, in leashing finance, in restoring faith in the capacity of government to do great things. We could even take Donald Trump's slogan, Make America Great Again, and define it as investing in public institutions, investing in infrastructure, investing in green transition. I think the public is really hungry for this kind of leadership. And Rich said in his introduction, look at all the movements, look at all the political consciousness, and I would add to that class consciousness. Can I say one more thing?
Sure.
Young people.
This is your show.
So there is a story that young people are being asked to internalize and make their own. Now, there has never been a generation quite as screwed as this generation. The decent work is not there. The affordable housing is not there. The health insurance is not there. The private pensions are not there. And yet, young people are being asked to internalize the following story. Hey, I don't need a big house. Big house wastes a lot of energy. I can go to Starbucks with my laptop. And I don't need a car. A bicycle is better for me anyway. Bicycle is more environmentally friendly. And it's okay that I have to move every year or two because I have to do that for my job anyway. Now, at some, maybe you buy that when you're 25. But when you're 35 and hoping to start a family, you realize that you have just been dealt a shit hand. And I think the politician who can narrate that, who can articulate that in a plausible way, will be the next president. I really do. And you contrast that with Pete Peterson's story of generational justice, where old folks who have decent pensions are robbing young people. This isn't about generation, it's about class. And young people without wealthy parents, by the way, if you have wealthy parents, you're exempted from this whole problem. This is a privatized head start. But if you don't have wealthy parents, what a miserable set of prospects, except for this thin elite. So I really do think the stars are in alignment for taking back our democracy, taking back our economy, and the two things go together.
Let me ask one more question, Bob, and then we'll open it up to the audience. A few years ago, a French Marxist by the name of Thomas Piketty became a best-selling author in the United States by arguing that the iron rules of capitalism made it inevitable that wealth and income would concentrate in a handful of people. That was bad, but nothing, according to Piketty, could be done about it. But you believe strongly that rising inequality is a matter of choice, that we can organize our way to a better world. Why do you believe that, Bob?
Well, I have a nice 30 or 40 year natural experiment where we proved it. Now, it is really hard. We had a tailwind in 1944. In 2018, we have headwinds. I think we have a political tailwind. We have the beginning of a political tailwind. But economically, so much damage has been done, so much power has reverted to big corporations, that it's at least as hard to reverse that as it was, say, in 1933. But it's possible. And in order to leash capitalism, you need a very big dose of social democracy. You need a very strong trade union movement. You need strong public institutions. You need very tight controls on capital, particularly on financial capital. You need a lot of public investment. But the thing about this is it works. It works. And when regular people see the results, they like the results. So it took a convergence of bad things happening in the 70s and bad leadership for this to be reversed. It's an ongoing struggle. Piketty, by the way, he's a terrific statistical historian. His account of why the 20th century was different, I think, was misleading in one key respect. Piketty looked at all of the wars in the 20th century, and he said that this was the one period where things became more equal, and that was because wars wiped out a lot of wealth, and by definition, wealth is held by wealthy people. He left out politics. The difference in the period between the 30s and 1972 is we had strong progressive politics. That's how we were able to enact policies that made the system much fairer for ordinary people. The policy is not hard. In the next hour, those of us in this room could design the entire policy agenda. The politics is the hard part.
Indeed. If you have a question, why don't you go to the mic, and I'll recognize you. And go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Over here.
Oklahoma and Arkansas, talking to our, it's not working, our members, because we've had some inter-member problems. Just want to see Rich.
And so what we've been trying to do with our department and the education department is to try and have the ability to talk about this stuff. We've been talking about it for a while, but now it's something that we can, the thoughts are coming together more clearly, let's put it that way. And our challenge in the labor movement is to figure out how to talk about this stuff where we're not talking down to people, but we're including people's experience and figuring out a way to, from the bottom up, make that conversation come into politics within our union, when it just, even in local politics, local union politics, but then it has obviously a bigger resounding effect. So I think that's a challenge to us in the labor movement, to get that conversation going, truly using our members' experience and broadening it from there. But then the other side is a question about, like, where does Roosevelt come from? How does another Roosevelt come along? And I think that Roosevelt had Eleanor, Francis Perkins, and several decades of New York politics that made Roosevelt Roosevelt. So I guess my question is twofold. What can we in the labor movement do better? And how can we kind of find a way that politics could react to us better, find our leadership?
Well, again, we kind of got lucky in 1933. Roosevelt was until he became president, he was an ideologically somewhat ambiguous figure, right? He was in favor of a balanced budget. I mean, he criticized Herbert Hoover from the right. And it was only after he became president that he stepped up and really saw the opportunity and he became Roosevelt. And yeah, there had been some interesting stuff that he had done as governor in New York State that sort of helped. But once he became president, he was a genius at narrating the life struggles of regular people in a way that nourished progressive politics. And there are people in politics who do that. Two of them are Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders. A third is Sherrod Brown. So there are people who know how to do that. And I think, now again, I am not going to tell you how to build a labor movement. That's, everybody in this room knows how to do that better than I do. I think the important thing is to validate.
I hope they stop hiding it.
The important thing is to validate the struggles of regular people in a way that teaches a political or an ideological lesson. Because if we don't do that, Donald Trump will, and Donald Trump has. And it's a simpler story. It's a story of demonizing others and racializing grievances. And Bannon was a master at that and taught Trump something of how to do that. But at the same time, there is no place in America that has more genuine inclusion than a union hall, where people can look across differences of race or national origin or gender. And granted, I'm romanticizing a little bit, but it's the labor movement at its best, and realize common interests. And I think so many people are getting screwed in this economy that the time is ripe to re-inject a sense of class, a sense of class oppression. People are eager to hear that validation.
I want to ask the people asking questions to please be as succinct with the question as you can so that we can get more of them in. We really appreciate that. Bob?
You bet. Bob, it's great to see you, and thank you for this wonderful talk. I can't wait to read the book. Here's a question for you. When conventional wisdom is wrong, like it is today when it comes to free trade and finance and so much other stuff, even good ideas seem crazy. Sometimes, from the point of view of a regular person, you know, out in the world, it's hard to distinguish crazy bad ideas from crazy good ideas. That's kind of where we're at. How can we separate out those ideas? How can we lift up these crazy good ones and knock down the crazy bad ones?
Well, you know, that's a function of leadership. I try to provide some of the analysis, some of the talking points. I mean, I think in the case of Trump and trade, it really isn't that difficult. He's right to criticize the trading system. It has not benefited regular people. It has sold out manufacturing. It has been tilted in favor of Wall Street. It has given a free pass to China. But if you're going to try and reset the trading system, you got to do it competently. You can't do it like a crazy person. And if you're going to try and bring China into a system as a well-behaved player, you can't raise tariffs on them on Tuesday and then cut a deal with them for ZTE because ZTE is bailing out one of your investments and helping your daughter on Wednesday. There's a hypocrisy. There's an incoherence. There's an ineptitude to it. And the funny thing about trade is that ordinary people, going back to Gephardt's fight in 88, they get that the trading system is rigged on behalf of somebody else. They get that it's a bad deal for them. So to that extent, a lot of the groundwork has been done. And the fact that Trump has kind of made off with this and done it in such a corrupt and incompetent way creates a challenge for us. It's not that free trade is good and protectionism is bad and Trump is a protectionist and therefore that just validates the free traders. The fact is that the trading system was rigged by Wall Street, by other elites. We need to take it back. And Trump has the right music, but he has the wrong words. So, you know, I'll help write that speech. But I think a lot of labor leaders get that intuitively, right? I mean, Leo Gerard can make that speech much better than I can and has been doing. And I think there's a receptive audience both for the critique and for the incompetence of Trump being exposed.
Thanks, Bob. Pat?
Yeah, Pat Malloy. I'm a trade lawyer, but I worked with Bob. He worked for Bill Proxmire, so did I, many years ago. I've read your book, Bob, and here's the point. You said that right-wing governments are coming into power in Europe and here. And that's not an inevitable product of globalization, properly constructed globalization. In fact, I think what Trump did was healthy for the Democratic Party because he's gotten us out, hopefully, out from under the control of the Wall Street crowd, and we have an opportunity to move back toward talking about class and economic issues rather than identity politics going forward. I just want to, and I see Sherrod Brown like you do as kind of the leader in that whole effort. But I want to see if that, how can we make that the key way to move our party forward? Because Wall Street still is going to be playing a big role in trying to select who we put in power as our Democratic nominee.
Well, we got to out-organize Wall Street, because if we get another Wall Street Democrat, God help us. I mean, all of the support on the part of frustrated regular people for demagogues and worse is just going to reinfect itself. I mean, can you imagine, pick one, Kirsten Gillibrand,
yeah.
Right? A kind of a fake progressive who's in bed with Wall Street, who doubles down on identity politics, and that's you know, we're going to get Trump, and the next president will be Ivanka. I mean, so if we don't break Wall Street's lock on the Democratic Party and get a progressive Democratic Party, we're going to lose our base, and Bannon will have won by redefining what should be pocketbook issues as demonization of others.
Thank you.
I just want to jump in for a second before I call on you. So the rules have been rigged in the political scheme as well, from Citizens United to doing all the gerrymandering that they're doing in districts so that they keep a majority there. How do we attack that, Bob? How do we attack the Citizens United and unlimited amounts that corporations can spend to buy the best Congress that they need?
Well, the only thing you can do is win by such a big margin that the seats that they steal are not sufficient to keep them in power, and mobilize so many people that the money ceases to be decisive. Then, once you're in power, you can reform the rules. And I'm not saying this is guaranteed, but I think we have a shot. We have a pretty good shot.
I just remind you that those rules were written by both parties and sanctified by the Supreme Court, which makes it just a tad more challenging for all of us to reverse.
And again, if you take back the presidency, maybe you get to appoint a couple of Supreme Court judges. I mean, this is. I'm not glossing over how tough this is. The damage that Trump has done, and for that matter, the damage that the last couple of Wall Street Democratic presidents have done, this is not going to be reversed overnight. I hope I live long enough to see it reversed in my lifetime. But I do think it's reversible.
Good. Yes.
Thank you. My name is Li Yang. I'm thinking that...
Can you pull the microphone down? So down, so there you go.
Yeah, thank you. My name is Li Yang. I think... what we are doing now, whether it's democracy or trade, I think what we need is a really good faith and have a fairness and some sort of justice. Currently, no matter which party you are talking about, they are really depend on what scheme they can play. There's no good faith. And so if you don't play a good faith, then everything will be different. Because good faith, you usually have select good people, capable people to lead our group, not something that you can cheat or profit over people. What I mean is really, you can rob people, then you can hire somebody else to cheat other people around. So that's why our society is getting worse. No matter how you do things, you elect one president after another, whether GOP or Democrats, it's getting worse. Because that system, why, is they are not really doing the things right. So do you think we can really have a system, maybe to teach, have some good material about integrity to teach us from student up to the administrators and faculty? Currently, the administrators in the school are really phony. They are doing things, bad things against the families. They destroy families. So I just want to know, for a system, why we must have good faith based on fairness and justice, and then select a good people up. Then they can have good thinking. Politics is really a very bad word.
Ask a question, please.
So that's why my question, do you think we can move this resolution to promote a fairness and justice and a good faith? Then, you know, with maybe some simple things like teaching material, so people have instilled their justice and integrity, their kind of character.
I do. I wouldn't be here if I were not optimistic about the ability of the system to regenerate, but it's going to take a lot of movement building and a lot of leadership.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Mindy Reiser. I'm a sociologist. I'm also vice president of an NGO called Global Peace Services USA. We work on peace building and conflict resolution. My question is this. There is a primary tomorrow here in Washington, D.C., and that leads me to the question of what to do on the local level. There is a lot of energy in local elections. There are progressive candidates. There are middle roaders. The states certainly have interesting experiments going on in policy and program. We, of course, care about what the union movement will do, but talk about some other actors in this drama, what some civil society organizations can do, how they can make an impact on their cities, on their county boards, on their states.
Well, let me start with state and local elections. One of the exciting things that's happening is that the focus is not just on Congress, it's not just on 2020, but the drum roll really started with Virginia and New Jersey, where thousands of people who have not been involved in electoral politics, many of whom come out of civil society organizations, are making that crossover from civil society organizations to running for a school board or city council or state rep. So that's really encouraging. And I think, to be honest, the tricky thing about civil society organizations is we have such a fragmentation of them. In the very first issue of the American Prospect, we published a piece by Karen Padgett with the title, Many Movements, No Majority. And because of the way so many civil society organizations are funded, there's a kind of rivalry where you're competing for foundation support, you're competing for membership, and you want to demonstrate that I'm a little bit different. You know, you do the grid of 100 rows this way and 100 rows that way, and my little box is a little bit different from her little box, and so you should fund me. And somehow we need a civil society that looks more like civil society did 100 years ago. Theda Scotchpole is the great historian of this, where it aggregates to power, it aggregates to movements, it aggregates to organizations that have local chapters and state chapters, and unlike the AARP, they're not phony, they're real. And that's hard, because in that era, of course, the unsung or sung heroes of civil society were women, because so many of them did not have jobs in the paid workforce. And now, to make ends meet, if you're a family, Both breadwinners are working two or three jobs. There's less time for civil society. So I think the encouraging thing here is that civil society, which has been very stymied by the C3, C4, can we do politics, can we not do politics, people who've been involved in civil society organizations are running for office. They're doing electoral politics, and that wall is being breached, because ultimately civil society has to add up to taking power. It can't just be civil society.
Lisa?
Hi, my name is Lisa Jordan. I'm the Director of Education for the Steelworkers. And as Steffi said, we constantly try to figure out how to have these conversations, and part of that starting back with our principles. And because our union was founded on a set of principles that came out of the mine workers back in the 1930s. So we start the conversation with there. But as an economist who's been doing this training for 30 years, what I figured out in recent history is the facts absolutely don't matter. Like, I can tell people all day that 30-year experiment, I can tell them the data, and they could give a crap. So it seems to me, in a local election we just had, we had two young women run against incumbent Democrats. Both were DSA members, and both kicked butt. One won with 60% of the vote, long-term incumbents. But what I'm not seeing is somebody who lives in Pittsburgh, I spend most of our time with my rank-and-file members, and I'm outside of kind of the intellectual left elite. I hear an optimism from you that the broader Democratic Party has people who are out there expressing these values that are going to bring back my members. My members who voted for Bernie in the primaries and voted for Trump in the election. Let's just be clear, that's what happened. I don't think they voted for a neo-fascist. I think they're anti-institutionalists. So I want to be really clear about that. But my question is, where do you see in the bigger Democratic Party all this optimism of somebody who's focusing on broad progressive values that are speaking to my members, that my members should actually listen, because outside of Bernie and Sherrod,
Elizabeth,
but I mean, so Bernie, Elizabeth, and Sherrod, those are the three, right?
All it takes is one.
All it takes is one, but I can tell you my members feel like the broader Democratic Party is bankrupt and the leadership needs to go, and until the leadership goes, they're not going back to the Democratic Party.
Okay.
So that's my question. Where do you see this vision coming from in the institution of the Democratic Party?
Well, boy, that's the best question of the day.
Yes.
So forget the freaking institution of the Democratic Party. Take the thing over. Right. You mentioned that a couple of DSA people who ran for office cleaned the clocks of the establishment candidates. There it is. And you mentioned that your members voted for Bernie before they voted for Trump. There it is. If you have candidates who are truth tellers from the perspective of the lived experience of regular people, you win. If you have the same old establishment crap, you lose. So the answer is take the damn thing over. I mean, there's the DNC, but the Institutional Democratic Party doesn't matter nearly as much as these grassroots candidates who will become the Democratic Party if they can do what the people who you described did.
Thanks, Bob. Yes?
Yes, my name's Ben Blake, and I'm actually the archivist for the AFL-CIO at University of Maryland. And I guess my question is, one thing that came up earlier in the discussion was how to validate the experience of the working class and the labor movement. So I'm wondering, as an archivist, maybe some ideas you might have on how I could better serve kind of the battle for democracy and kind of in the era of so-called fake news and those kind of things. How do you defend actual facts and real history? And how can we serve, you know, this sort of battle for democracy and the labor movement? Maybe ideas you have or what I should do. I'm trying to figure out ways that I can improve what I'm doing and kind of overcome the isolation that Archives kind of has in terms of the movement.
Boy, that may be too big a question. I mean, it's a wonderful question. And I don't have an easy answer. I mean, we all do what we do. You know, I try to write stuff. I try to research books. I try to explain things in ways that will be politically useful. And I think if there are things in your work that unearth stories that are politically useful in the current circumstances. I mean, here's a story. Who did I steal this from? Can't remember. But this is in the context of whether, and it's an example of archival research having a contemporary use. That's the reason I bring it up. There's a lot of debate about whether there's something about this stage of capitalism that requires what David Weil calls the fissuring of employment, the dividing of real jobs, payroll jobs, into contract work and temp work and all kinds of crap work. And in looking at this, I stumbled on a strike of subway workers, I think it was 1903 in New York. This is referenced in the book. And what were they striking for? Well, they had hired, they were mostly Italian immigrants, and the people, the company that had the contract to build the subway had hired Italian padrones, bosses, to hire casual labor. And they were striking for the right to be paid salaries because they knew that if they were going to be casual labor, they'd always be casual labor, and they'd be played off against each other. Same thing was going on in the garment industry at the same time with jobbers. And you look at this little piece of history, you realize that there is nothing new about the struggle to regularize work. That's what the labor movement has always been about. If you go back another 100 years, hardly anybody had regularized work. Everybody was a casual employee. And so I use that story when I argue with people who say that, oh, well, Uber, Lyft, technology, of course it makes logical sense that work would be casualized. No, that's nonsense. That's about power. It's about who has the power to set the rules. And I think there are stories you can tell based on archival research that have a lot of relevance to current debates.
You know, the other thing I might suggest to you is we have a number of really, really quality labor educators that are talking to workers every single day. We have a number of communication people that talk to members every single day. When you come up with a useful story or an example that you think is effective, I'd really urge you to share it with them so that they can amplify you, get it out everywhere, and help us spread that word, because there's a whole lot to be learned from where we came, and we just need to synthesize a little more.
And by the way, the great political leaders are all great storytellers.
Let me ask one question before I call on the other two. You have a chapter in your book that says why the United States needs to lead. And you know, Bob, it really feels right now that we may be further away from that than we've ever been in your lifetime, in my lifetime. So let me just ask you, why does the United States need to lead? And what are the consequences of an America First approach?
Well, I mentioned this in passing a few minutes ago. I mean, you look around the rest of the world and you ask the question, where else is progressive leadership going to come from? And the answer is nowhere. I mean, conceivably, the Labor Party under Jeremy Corbyn, who's kind of a Bernie Sanders lefty, maybe if Theresa May keeps screwing up the way she's screwing up, British Labour could get back into power under a lefty. That's the only other exception I can think of. But the United States has to lead because you can't imagine the circumstances coming together for Europe leading. Europe is fragmented. Europe is in the clutches of the far right. Even where Europe is not in the clutches of far right, it's stymied by the rules of the EU. So the U.S. needs to lead because the U.S. has to lead. And by the way, if Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren or Sherrod Brown were to get elected president, that would have incredible ramifications for the rest of the world. It would suddenly say, well, wait a minute. A very different version of America is back. Not only is it America that is playing a constructive role in the world, but it's an America that's playing a progressive role in the world. And in order to be a kind of a model for economics that serves regular people to not only take back our democracy and our economy in this country, but to provide an alternative to the movement towards neo-fascism, America has to lead.
Do just one follow-up on that.
Yep.
We swing from being progressive to far right. Does that swing destroy our credibility, and how long will it take for us to earn that credibility back so we can actually lead again as a nation?
That's a great question. I just had this argument with, there's a word in Yiddish for this, but there's no word in English for it. It's my son's father-in-law, okay? He's a former ambassador, State Department guy. And I was saying, I thought that if we elected a great president, it would not take all that long to regain some credibility, because there would be an enormous amount of relief, and the roots of common interest between the United States and Europe go back a very long way, and Trump would be seen as a horrible anomaly. And he was saying, don't kid yourself about how much damage is being done. And would countries really worry that the United States would be as good as its word, because 4 years later, somebody completely different might be elected. So I think it would take a while. But of course, the great thing about the Roosevelt era was that it lasted 20 years. And that was long enough to build enduring relationships. So one hopes that the next progressive era will last 20 years.
Thanks, Bob. Thank you for your patience.
Sure. Actually, that conversation sort of gets to the question I had. My name's Barbara Sofol, and it was that if everything falls into place and progressives control our levers of government here in the United States after the 2020 election, you know, can we drive the global change that is necessary to revert to the policies that created better circumstances for everybody around the world if the other democracies haven't made that change to progressive leadership?
I think you have to take it issue by issue. I mean, if the United States under President Warren or President Sanders were to say, okay, we need to rebuild the trading system. We're not going to have indiscriminate tariff wars, but we are going to insist that countries that want their products to be admitted tariff-free to the United States need to have minimal social standards, minimal environmental standards. We're not going to allow countries that practice a kind of predatory state capitalism to have their products admitted as if they were normal countries. I think you would get a lot of Western Europe saying, okay, we get that. I mean, there are a lot of other separate issues like protecting farm trade. I mean, trade is so damn complicated. But on the big picture of social norms in trade, if the United States made that its primary goal, I think it could bring other countries around. And then you've got all the other stuff that, you know, just normal foreign policy stuff, where Trump gets in bed with Putin. Maybe that's not such a great idea. Just normal stuff. Where I think the rest of the world would breathe, certainly the rest of the democratic world would breathe a sigh of relief. And then, you know, Reagan quoted a Russian proverb, trust but verify. They'd be waiting to see whether we were as good as our word. But boy, would there be relief on the part of the rest of the world.
Yeah, the Italians said it a little differently. They said, to trust is good. To not trust is better. Yes.
My name is Jim Birch, and I've noticed a lot of the questions, almost all the questions are, what silver bullet do we have to kill these guys off? Where can we hit them in their Achilles heel and they go down? And then we get answers that sound pretty good, but they're not quite there. And I'm just wondering, and I like your thoughts on this. You may not have thought of this before. Can you kill them with humor? Can you say, you just shake off all the stuff about going into a nice debate, and you talk a good story. And then when they ask these questions, you say, are you kidding me? Are you real? Is this, are you kidding? And laugh at them. I think that would do them in, but maybe not.
I don't know. Look, I'm not saying this is a slam dunk. This is going to be really, really hard. I'm just saying it's possible. And it's one part movement building and leadership at all levels and one part leadership at the top level. And we may get lucky, we may not get lucky. I mean, we may have, Kirsten Gillibrand is the nominee and Trump will get reelected. I have no idea how the next 6 months are going to play out with Mueller and with impeachment, and all I know is it's going to be very interesting. But I think the odds are it's going to be better for our side than it is for their side.
Cool. Hi. Loved your book.
Thank you.
And I also read Wilhelm Streeck's book, The End of Capitalism.
Yep.
And at first I thought you guys were disagreeing, but I don't think you are now, because he doesn't ask, will capitalism survive? He's saying it won't. And it's just, how will it end? I guess what I'm asking you, he also puts his focus on the nation state. And at first I thought, God, it's more nationalism. But it seems to me you're doing the same thing. You're saying that it's got to be, and just like there's two types of globalism, I think you're saying, there's two
right.
types of nationalism.
Yes, thank
Isn't
you.
Isn't that what you're saying? You go
very,
ahead.
Very much so. And Streeck, the difference is Streeck is famously pessimistic.
Yes, he is.
He's gloomy. And I think temperamentally, whether I can justify it or not, I'm optimistic. But here's a secret. I'm not really an economist. I'm a political scientist doing political economy. And the political scientist in me appreciates that there is something called the polity. The polity is the political community where democracy exists or doesn't exist. And there is no global polity. I am not a citizen of the Republic of the WTO. I'm a citizen of the United States of America. This is where I get to vote. This is where I get to elect my leaders. And the idea that there is somehow a global polity is not just a fantasy, but it's a very clever manipulation by financial elites. That if they can sell this story that, oh, well, the market has totally overtaken the state, the state is an anachronism, anybody who believes in the state is a crazy nationalist. No, that's wrong. The state, for better or for worse, is where democracy either exists or doesn't exist. And Danny Roderick is the other great writer on this, that globalization undermines the capacity of the state to have a balance between markets and other forces,
mm-hmm.
between markets and civil society, between markets and democracy. And when that happens, and markets go nuts, people turn to fascists. So as much as we all might like to be a different sort of globalist, a one-world federalist sort of thing, the state is where we build democracy.
Mm-hmm.
And it was Friedrich Hayek, of all people, who in 1938 said, I am a European federalist because with a European federation, the federation would be too weak to regulate capitalism, and the member states would be too weak to regulate capitalism. And that's exactly what has happened with the EU.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Bob,
can I ask one more question, Rich? It really is important to me.
If it's a short question.
I'm on the Central Committee of the party in Virginia. I remember when I was campaigning for John Kerry in 2004, I would say, Bush is shipping your jobs to Asia, and he's shipping your kids to Iraq. I think that the over-involvement of the U.S. in military affairs around the world, including 18 years in Afghanistan, and nobody quite understands, well, I think that's another key issue for Democrats to really think about and talk about, because I think most of the American people don't like what's happening in our over-involvement militarily around the world.
Pep, I just say the way you talk about that's extremely important as well. Because if you denigrate the sacrifice made by the people, those soldiers that have been over there for 18 years, it hits home and people turn against you pretty quickly because that was their sacrifice and their family's sacrifice that was made. the debate over whether to have a war or not, I think is fair game and should be had. But any way that detracts from the men and women that were sent over there who shed blood, sweat, and tears, I think we have to be awful careful about and stay away from, because that's our kids. Most of those kids over there are working class kids.
Yep.
Bob, I don't know if you want to comment.
No, I mean, I pretend to know a lot about a lot of things, but this is not something I take on in any kind of detail.
You know, Bob, you've been extremely generous with your time. I want to say that I believe not just every progressive, but every American should read that book, your book. Take it to heart, debate it, so that as a society, we could actually start talking about issues like that. Let me turn it back over to you for any closing comments, any summation you want to make.
Well, the only summation is, Rich, thanks for having me, and thanks for everything that you do, and thanks to all of you for coming. Buy the book.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody, for coming out. Thank you, President Trumka. Thank you, Robert Kuttner, for being here. There is a reception right outside, so if you want to keep the conversation going, you're welcome to stay and enjoy some food and light refreshments. Also, if you haven't bought the book, we are selling the book. Oops, sorry. Hang on.